we have 10 to the 15 different nanoparticles. So we have 10 to the 15 different isomeric structures. So this is a tremendously large number. And of course, all these different nanoparticles, they have different stabilities and different application properties, such as chemical adsorption, which plays an important role in catalysis. Now, why adsorption plays a role in catalysis? because imagine that you have these catalyst pellets and we feed the reactants on the left side and we get the products on the right-hand side. So, of course, you understand that the interactions of your reagents with the catalyst plays an important role. And this is exemplified by the Sabatier principle, which basically says that in order to have an active catalyst, you need the interactions between the catalyst and your reagents to be just right. What I mean just right, neither too weak, because if you have weak adsorption of your reagents, here I color them with blue and red, then they don't reside, your reactants don't reside on the catalyst surface, and they will not meet to react and to have products. On the other hand, if you have very strong adsorption, for example, here the blue reactant has very strong adsorption, you see that only one reactant is on the surface of the catalyst. The red reactant does not reside on the surface, and basically your catalyst is simply poisoned by the most strongly bound species on its surface. However, when you have this perfect binding, the just right binding, both of your reactants, the blue and the red, can reside on the catalyst surface. They can meet each other, they can react, and you can have the products, you can have reactions. Now, this is a qualitative picture of the of catalysis through the Sabatier principle, but we have also a quantitative picture, which comes actually from the Brosin-Evans-Polanyi relationships, the so-called BEP relationships, which are dated back in the 1930s, and they have been developed for homogeneous chemistries. But in catalysis, they have been introduced by Professor Michaelidis from the Thomas Young Center of London, has applied them in computational catalysis. And of course, these are very famous now in computational catalysis. Other groups such as Jens Norskov have also done a lot of work. Also, Mikhail has been using this in combination with kinetic Monte Carlo simulations. And what these wonderful relationships tell us is that you can relate now the activation energy of a reaction with the reaction energy on your catalyst surface. So basically you relate the kinetics with the thermodynamics. And the reaction energy is basically related also to the adsorption. For example, here we have the carbon monoxide dissociation on different metal surfaces, and you see that the binding, the reaction energy here corresponds to the binding of carbon and oxygen on the catalyst surface. So these relationships have been demonstrated on metals, but we have also demonstrated this on metal oxides. And this is an example from our recent work, where we have investigated the dehydrogenation of alkanes on gamma alumina, on different sides, dual pairs of gamma alumina. And what we have done is that we have related the rate limiting step, the kinetics or the activation energy of the rate limiting step, with a single thermodynamic descriptor being the binding energy of dissociated hydrogen on these pair sites on gamma alumina. And you see that we have a straight line. Actually, through these relationships, you can develop the so-called volcano plots in catalysis, where you can estimate the total catalytic activity, the turnover frequencies on your catalyst, again, having as a descriptor, a thermodynamic descriptor, here the binding energy of hydrogen, and you can identify the most active site or the most active catalyst at the top of your volcano plot. All right, so with chemical adsorption playing an important role in catalysis, we developed back in 2010 the first adsorption model on nanoparticles. And we had related the binding energy of carbon monoxide with structural characteristics of gold nanoparticles. And the descriptors that we used was the coordination number and the curvature, this angle that I show you here, of the adsorption site. Now, why these two descriptors are important descriptors in the adsorption of carbon monoxide? Metal nanoparticles have metals on their surface or with different coordination environments. So when you go to low coordinated sites, these sites are chemically unsaturated. So they tend to bind the adsorbates much more strongly than the higher coordinated sites. In addition, when you go to corners and edges, these are sites that they tend to localize electron density. And these sites tend also to bind stronger the adsorbates. So that's why the angle or the curvature of the site, and again, corners and edges have high curvatures, that's why they bind stronger the reactants. So what is the importance of this model? Now experimentalists can have an estimate of the adsorbates binding energy on the nanoparticle surface by just knowing the nanoparticle characteristics which can come from spectroscopic studies. All right, so again, our model was developed back in 2010, and it takes into consideration structural characteristics of your catalyst. After that, Professor Philippe Sautet in 2014 and his co-workers introduced the generalized coordination numbers, which basically, in addition to the coordination number of the site, they take into consideration the coordination numbers of the second neighbors of this site. And this is very similar with the curvature effect, which basically you take into consideration the site, the total site of your adsorption. In 2017, Professor Hong Liazin from Virginia Tech introduced the orbital-wise coordination numbers, which in addition to the coordination environment of your site, they take into consideration electronic structure of the surface. And more recently, in 2017, Rowling and Peterson introduced the surface scaling relations, where basically they demonstrated that the binding energy of your adsorbate is correlated to the binding energy of the metal site on your catalyst, so the metal that this adsorbate binds and how this binds on the catalyst. All right, so how can we use now these models? And I will show you an example from our research. First of all, this is an example on the CO oxidation, carbon monoxide oxidation on gold. First of all, you can calculate the equilibrium shapes of gold nanoparticles at different sizes. And you can do this by combining density functional theory and Wolf construction methods. And here I show you how the morphology of gold nanoparticles changes when you go from 1.5 all the way to 10 nanometers. And then when you expose it to a reaction environment, such as the carbon monoxide, you see that the nanoparticles become more spherical. Here the yellow colors represent high coordinated sites, whereas the green colors represent low coordinated sites on the nanoparticle. So then what we can do, we can calculate the distribution of the different sites, surface sites on your nanoparticles, and we can calculate the coordination numbers and the angles that I mentioned before. And with our adsorption model, we can calculate an overall carbon monoxide adsorption response of your nanoparticles. And this is shown in this black data, black points and black line, all right? And if you see this carbon monoxide, average carbon monoxide binding energy response of your nanoparticles correlates with all these data points, different colored points, which are carbon monoxide oxidation experiments that have been performed on gold nanoparticles of ranging diameters from 2 all the way to 30 nanometers, supported on all these different metal oxide supports. And these experiments have been collected over a period of 25 years. And you see that these experiments correlate with, again, this line, which is a single thermodynamic descriptor. It's the average carbon monoxide binding energy on the surface of gold nanoparticles. So we can show that we can predict catalytic activity as a function of nanoparticle morphology. All right, so this brings me to the motivation of this work with nanoparticle morphology affecting the properties such as adsorption, catalysis, and of course the stability of your materials. And also with the fact that we don't have many models that can predict nanoparticle behavior as a function of the morphological characteristics of the nanoparticles, and also as a function of the metal composition, Then what we do is that we want to develop models that can describe the thermodynamic stability and chemical adsorption as a function of any nanoparticle morphology, any size, any shape, and any metal composition. And we want also to these models to be able to screen rapidly and accurately bimetallics behavior. And the most important thing is that we want to go beyond the DFT size limitations, the size limitations that are imposed by density functional theory calculations, which are basically limited on a couple of hadron, a hadron to a couple of hadron metal atoms. All right. So this is the research approach that we followed in this project, but also this is the typical research approach that we have been following in the last couple of years in our lab. So first we calculate the properties of nanomaterials with first principles calculations. And then we use machine learning to develop structure property relationships, such as, for example, symbolic regression, et cetera, and also to screen nanomaterials behavior through the development of genetic algorithms. And I will discuss about this later. All right, so the first thing that we wanted to investigate, to address, is the stability of the nanoparticles. And we optimized the morphologies of different nanoparticles. You see here that we have nanoparticles of different sizes and different shapes. And we also changed the type of metals that we have, and we focus here on coinage metals, being the silver, gold, and copper metals. All right, and we describe the stability of the nanoparticles through the cohesive energy, which is the average binding energy, the binding energy per atom on your nanoparticle. We also use this empirical relationship that has been introduced back in the 1980s by Professor Tomanek at Michigan State University, which basically says that you can calculate the cohesive energy of any metal particle by knowing the cohesive energy of your metal in bulk and scaling according to the atoms that you have and their coordination environment on your particle, all right? So this is the expression that we call also, this is the square root bone cutting model, again, that has been introduced by Tomanek. All right, so first we tested the square root bone cutting model against the cohesive energy that we calculated with density functional theory calculations for all these different nanoparticles that I mentioned before. And you see that it does a very good job to predict the stability of metal nanoparticles in terms of their cohesive energy. Also, you will notice that as we increase the nanoparticle size, the cohesive energy increases, it becomes more negative, more thermodynamically stable. So this is because simply you increase the nanoparticle size and you increase the number of bonds that take place on these nanoparticles and of course the cohesion of your nanoparticle. All right, so the square root bone cutting model is also able to differentiate between different shapes at a specific size. So for example, here you can see that it can capture that the icosahedral symmetry is more stable than the rest of the symmetries on the 55 metal atoms, metal atom nanoparticles. And then when we tested our model, the square root bone cutting model on bimetallic nanoparticles, and here is the case of copper silver. And what we have done is that we have played with, we have changed the composition of these nanoparticles in a random fashion. And again, the nanoparticles have different size, different shapes, etc. You see that the square root bone cutting model now deviates from the calculations using density functional theory. So that was a motivation for us to develop a new model, and we call this model bone-centric model, that what it does, it is similar to the square root bone cutting model, that it takes into consideration the local chemical environment through the coordination numbers that I mentioned before. And of course we have the cohesive energy of the metals, but also it describes now more accurately the bimetallic bone strength by using these scaling factors that I show you here, these gamma values that are being developed through diatomic bond dissociation energy data. And this can be either experimental or it can be calculated with a high level of ab initio calculations. All right, so now you will see, of course, if you want to have more details about this model, you can visit our website and you can see this nice video that explains the details of the bond-centric model that we have developed. But now what is important is that with this model, we can predict now much more accurately the stability of bimetallic nanoparticles. So that was good news, and we wanted to test it, our model, in an experimental nanoparticle. And this is a nanoparticle that has been synthesized. It consists of 23,196 atoms of iron and platinum. The iron composition is 28% and the platinum is 72%. And this nanoparticle has been characterized with atomic precision. So we know exactly the chemical ordering of this nanoparticle. So what we did, we took this nanoparticle, but we just constrained the size and the shape of the nanoparticle. And we tried to come up with different chemical orderings of these two metals of the nanoparticle and calculate the cohesive energy of the nanoparticle. And we did that by having the exact same composition as I mentioned before, but placing the iron and platinum atoms at different positions in terms of the surface or subsurface of the nanoparticle. And you see that for each different chemical ordering, we have completely different stability, different cohesive energy of your nanoparticle. But what is important is that among the ones that we have the most stable chemical orderings is the one that has been experimentally synthesized. So this gave us a lot of confidence, and we thought, okay, why don't we automate this process, because it's a very tricky process, and optimize the chemical ordering of any given nanoparticle by having constrained size, shape, and metal composition in your nanoparticle. And we did this by developing a genetic algorithm. And here is how our genetic algorithm behaves. This is the predictions that we get for this exact same experimental nanoparticle that I mentioned before. And this is the most stable nanoparticle that our genetic algorithm predicts. And what I show you here is a histogram of the metal composition going in iron and platinum. These different colors are iron and platinum, going from the core of the nanoparticle all the way to the surface of the nanoparticle. And what you see is that this metal composition is very similar to the composition that we expect, to the composition profile of the experimental nanoparticle. And now if you were to use a random search, it would fail simply because you would be trapped on the initial conditions and you have an extremely large material space to screen. So you see that the metal composition that we get with random search is not in agreement with experiments. And this is depicted on this other example that I show you of gold copper nanoparticles that have close to 3,000 metal atoms. And what you will see here, this is our genetic algorithm, and you see that within a couple of thousand generations, we start to get nanoparticles which have, which are highly stable, have high cohesive energy. Whereas if you were to use the random search, you will see that you would be basically trapped on the initial conditions. And again, we have a tremendously large material space. That's why random search will fail. What is interesting here is that you see that our genetic algorithm predicts finally that this nanoparticle will have a core shell architecture compared to the initial guess that we inputted. And actually this is in agreement with experiments that they predicted this core cell mixing behavior in silver copper. The nice thing about our genetic algorithm that, is that it can screen now 1.5 million nanoparticles and at a rate of 70,000 nanoparticles per minute. And you can do this in a regular desktop computer that you have in your house. All right. So having now automated the optimization of the chemical ordering, we thought, okay, why don't we screen a large number of nanoparticles? In this case, we screened close to 5,500 nanoparticles that have different sizes. And here I just like they range from 13 atoms all the way to 3,871. And I just show you here just three sizes, the smallest, the largest, and the one which is intermediate. And we have three different shapes, the elongated pentagonal bipyramid, the cuboctahedral symmetry, and the icosahedral symmetry. And we have three different bimetallic compositions, gold, copper, silver gold, and silver copper. And what you will see is that these are the predictions of our genetic algorithm. You see that, again, silver copper prefers core cell architectures, whereas silver gold prefers well-mixed bimetallic architectures, and gold copper lies somewhere in the middle of these two behaviors. All right, and of course, our predictions, computational predictions, are in agreement with many experiments in literature. All right, so my students came up with this composition plot now, that it's a nice way to visualize the mixing of these nanoparticles. And how you read these plots is that here we plot the fraction of the homometallic bonds on your nanoparticle. So the higher you see the lines of mixing, they go to this point, the higher the mixing of your nanoparticle, because you increase now the number of heteroatomic bonds on your nanoparticle. The line that you see here is the random mixing plot. So it's when the two metal atoms are randomly mixed. And whatever is below this random mixing shows that the nanoparticles do not like to mix, the metals do not like to mix with each other. Whereas if it is higher than that, they show that the nanoparticles like to mix with each other. And we did this again for the nanoparticles of different sizes, which range from 13 all the way to 3,871 atoms. Here is the plot for copper gold, that you see that basically we have a random mixing behavior, more or less. Whereas when you go to gold silver, you see that we have a high tendency for these metals to mix with each other. You see that these plots are much higher than the random mixing plot. On the contrary, when you have the silver copper, you see that all these different particles of different sizes and different compositions, they don't like to mix with each other, so that's why their plots are lower than the random mixing line that I show you here. It is interesting to see that when you have small nanoparticles, they tend to go closer to the line of the random mixing, which also reveals a nanoscale behavior in the mixing of your metals. All right, so what we did next, we calculated the configurational entropy, and we calculated the Gibbs free energy of your nanoparticles, and we developed these phase diagrams that now we can rationalize at a specific size and a specific metal composition. We can rationalize the thermodynamic preference of your nanoparticles towards a specific shape. So for silver gold, you will see that the nanoparticles, and I forgot to mention that the reaction conditions are room temperature. So we evaluate this at room temperature. So you see here that gold, silver, they prefer, when they mix with each other, they prefer to have all these three different shapes. But then when you go to silver copper, you have a slight preference for the EPB and cuboctahedral symmetry compared to the icosahedral. And things completely change when you have gold copper nanoparticles, where you see that the EPB and especially the cuboctahedral shape dominates with respect to the icosahedral shape. All right. So having generated this very rich data of, again, close to 5,500 different nanoparticles, which have different sizes, different shapes, and different metal compositions, we thought to develop a database that we call MetaNanoDB, and we did this in collaboration with the computer science department of the University of Pittsburgh. And we developed this database, which will be available October 1st, free of charge, and this is the website. And my student here, James Dean, will present in this short video what this database can do. And again, this is free for the scientific community to utilize it.
To make our data readily accessible, we'd like to introduce Metal NanoDB, a collaborative effort between the Canela and ADMT labs at the University of Pittsburgh to deliver a large, easily searchable database of over 5,000 metal nanoparticles. To start, select the two elements of interest. Here we select copper and gold. Next, select the shape for your cluster. Currently, three are available: icosahedron, cube octahedron, and an elongated pentagonal bipyramid. Then select the size, which can be chosen either by the number of atoms or diameter. Then choose the number of atoms in the cluster. Here we select 309 atoms. Then choose the range of compositions you'd like. In this case, we go from roughly 49% to 80% gold. Then choose the maximum number of results you'd like returned. Let's set the limit to 500 in case there's a lot of results. And we get 96 total clusters. We can export this data into a CSV format for further analysis. For example, perhaps we want to determine the excess energy as a function of copper content. Next, it might make sense to view entries that are of interest. Here, we select the lowest excess energy in this set of search results. We see a plot of excess energy versus gold content and a list of various properties, the same found in our CSV from earlier. We can slice through the particle with the slider to get an idea of what it looks like on the inside. Finally, you can download the nanoparticle in XYZ or chemical JSON format for use in your favorite computational chemistry code, for the creation of excellent figures and promotional material, or anything else that you can think of. We look forward to seeing what you can do with our database. When you use it,
all right, so this is basically what the database can do. And what we did the next, So having investigated how the stability of the metal nanoparticles changes as a function of size, shape, and metal composition, now we want to connect to the application property. And we want to develop a generalized adsorption model that we can predict the adsorption of different adsorbates based on the morphological characteristics of the metal nanoparticles and of the adsorption site on the metal nanoparticles. So we calculate the adsorption of methyl and hydroxy radicals and carbon monoxide. These are very important reaction intermediates in catalysis on metal nanoparticles which have different sizes, different shapes, and different metal composition. Again, we investigate coinage metals, silver, copper, and gold. And of course, we take into consideration many different adsorption sites on the nanoparticles. And this is the model that we generated that it has three major features in order to relate the binding energy of the adsorbates with the characteristics of your nanoparticles and of your adsorbates. So the features or descriptors, if you will, are the cohesive energy, the local cohesive energy of your adsorption site that I show you here, all right? And this can be calculated by the bond-centric model that we developed and I presented earlier. The second descriptor is this IPA, which is basically an estimation of the chemical potential of your adsorbate in the gas phase through the hard-soft acid-base theory, which is basically the negative average of the ionization potential and electron affinity of your adsorbate. And these are very fast to calculate, or you can find them tabulated. and finally, we have this MADS descriptor, which stands for the metal adsorbate interaction. So this is simply the binding energy of your adsorbate with a single metal atom that it binds. And of course, you can calculate this very fast with density functional theory calculations. This is, you know, the order of minute or less calculation. All right. And again, this is the expression of our model, and let's see how it behaves. Now, when we train and test our model on the monometallic nanoparticles, you see that we have, again, the different attributes on different nanoparticles of different composition. These are monometallic nanoparticles. You see that it does a very good job to predict the trends. Now, what we did, we trained our model on the monometallic nanoparticles, but we applied it on, or we tested on bimetallic nanoparticles that the model has never seen. And you see that it can predict the adsorption trends on the bimetallic nanoparticles. So we get the trends. So this is very, very good news. So the model extends to bimetallic nanoparticle adsorption based on the monometallic nanoparticles. Then what we did, we also used the data of Rowling and Peterson. These are rich data on periodic density function theory calculations, adsorption on periodic surfaces. And when we trained our model and we tested on their data, you see that it does a very, very good job to predict also adsorption on periodic surfaces. Okay, so now why this model is now important? Because we have now a mathematical way to describe chemical intuition. And what I mean is that we know that low coordinated sites of the nanoparticles will have lower cohesive energy. They will be less stable as sites on the nanoparticles, all right? But these sites are the sites that they bind stronger the adsorbates. And now we have a way to describe this, a mathematical way to describe this. And this is very important. This is very important because now, if you are working on catalyst design and optimization of materials, you have a mathematical description to optimize nanomaterials by taking into consideration their stability and also their application performance, in this case, the adsorption response. So this is very important in terms of materials screening. This is the slide of the evolution of the adsorption models that I described at the beginning of my talk. And here is where our generalized adsorption model stands. In addition now to having, to take into consideration the geometry of the surface, structural characteristics of your nanoparticles, and also metal composition, our model is able to describe different adsorbates. So we can screen different adsorbates. It's a generalized model. I didn't show you how it is transferable to other adsorbates that the model has not seen because I didn't have a lot of time, but it is also, it can screen different adsorbates because again, it is generalized in its nature. All right, so how can I bring everything now together? How can I advance computational catalyst design and the field of computational catalysis? The field of computational catalysis has been primarily focusing on periodic density functional theory calculations on well-defined crystallographic facets. But now, with these models, with the cohesive energy descriptions of my nanoparticles, what I can do, I can select a nanoparticle size that is of experimental interest, and in this case is around 2 nanometers, and we focus on rhodium nanoparticles, and I can calculate the stability through these cohesive energy models of different nanoparticle shapes, and I can play also with the size regime. And I can now calculate how my stability of nanoparticles change when I have nanoparticle ensembles instead of one thermodynamically most preferred nanoparticle. So now I can take into consideration nanoparticle ensembles with effect of temperature, reaction conditions. But not only that, I can also calculate how the equilibrium shape of my nanoparticles change in the presence of a reaction environment, such as carbon monoxide in this case, all right? And I can see how this nanoparticle ensemble now, the different shapes change in the presence of a reaction environment. And I can calculate the distribution of the sites on my ensemble on the different nanoparticle shapes that I have under realistic reaction conditions in the presence of chemical adsorbates. And here what I show you with the different colors is these are the sites that you, the sites on the nanoparticle that you would calculate when you have in blue the ground state nanoparticle, what you would predict, for example, with a Wolf construction, it's a single nanoparticle, and how these sites change when you take into consideration an ensemble of nanoparticles at different chemical environment conditions and at different temperatures that I show you here. And you see now what is important here is that you see that these B5 sites, they appear only when you take into consideration your nanoparticle ensemble. And why this is important? Because these sites are most active sites for the CO carbon monoxide dissociation on rhodium. And now you see that by taking into consideration nanoparticle ensembles, you can predict completely different reactivity rather than by having simulations on your most thermodynamically preferred single nanoparticle of a specific morphology. So with that, I would like to conclude. I hope that I showed you today that we have constructed some simple physics-based models that can describe nanoparticle stability and chemical adsorption and can capture the behavior in both monometallic and bimetallic nanoparticles. We developed a genetic algorithm that can optimize the chemical order and can identify the most stable bimetallic morphology. And with these models, we can enable the high throughput screening of nanoparticle properties in terms of stability and also application behavior, mixing properties, etc. And the important thing is that these models are orders of magnitude faster than density function theory calculations. Again, we would be limited with DFT calculations on a couple of hundred metal atoms, whereas experiments use nanoparticles that are of 1,000 metal atoms. And with this, I hope that I demonstrated that with these models, we can advance nanomaterials design. I would like to mention that we distribute all our models and our codes are free of charge, of course, on GitHub. So you are very welcome to visit our GitHub page and download the codes and apply it to your research. With that, I would like to acknowledge the contribution of a very talented team that I have at the University of Pittsburgh, specifically Michael Cove and James Dean. They are both PhD students in my lab. They developed the genetic algorithm code. James has also worked on the adsorption, on the generalized adsorption model. Zihao Yan was a master student in my lab, and now he's a PhD student at Virginia Tech. And he worked very closely with a former PhD student in my lab, an NSF fellow, Michael Taylor. Michael is now a postdoc at MIT. They both worked together and they developed this, the bone-centric model that I described earlier. And Rafael Keula is a PhD, was a PhD student in Professor Matteo Maestri's lab at Politecnico di Milano in Italy. And he visited our lab for a year and he applied our models on the rhodium, on the CO dissociation on rhodium that I showed you in my last slide. And of course, I would like to acknowledge Professor Matteo Maestri and Professor Panos Chrysanthis, who is a faculty full professor in the computer science department at University of Pittsburgh. And we developed jointly the Metal NanoDB database. This work has been primarily funded by the National Science Foundation. And I would like also to acknowledge computational support from the Center for Research Computing at the University of Pittsburgh and supercomputing facilities at EXID and NERSC in the United States. So thank you very much for your attention and I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Yanni, for this excellent talk. And the floor is now open to questions. Are there any questions from the audience? I guess, Karen, can the... can they write the questions on the chat area?
Of course, yeah, we can raise hands or enter a question on the chat or just unmute. I think everybody can unmute themselves.
Okay, that's fine. So if somebody wants to ask a question.
So this is Chung from University of Surrey. Thank you very much for the very impressive work. I enjoyed your talk very much. In your example you showed for the metal nano DB, you showed a binary metal composition. Do you also have ternary
That's an excellent question. So this is the next step in our research. We don't have right now, but we are modifying our genetic algorithm to both explore and exploit multi-metallic nanoparticle behavior. And we expect that in a year or so, we will have also a database that takes into consideration multi-metallics. So far, we have binary metals.
Yeah, thank you. And so do you have all the metals in your database?
We have all the coinage metals, silver, copper, and gold. And if you go on our GitHub, you may find also nanoparticles with zirconium, copper zirconium, etc. These are the metals that we have optimized their chemical orderings.
Okay, yeah, thank you, great. I look forward to the release of that, and maybe we can make use of it.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, are there any more questions from the audience?
Yeah, so I wanted to ask, it's Alex Schluger from UCL. So some of these clusters are softer than others with respect to adsorption of, say, CO, for example, because it's known that they change their shape, right? So if you have a pressure of, say, CO, for example, on gold, then instead of this pointy shape, you start getting some kind of pancakes and stuff like that. Then when you mix them with copper or something, this may change. So how this is taken into account in these simulations? I mean, the fact that, because I see that, and I must say it's an excellent talk indeed. I mean, I really appreciate it. But I see at the end you were talking about the pressure of, say, CO in that case. And so if you take that pressure into account, so how the shape of nanoclusters is changing, actually, and for binaries, how does it get affected?
Sure, that's an excellent question, because the tricky here is the binary. So what I mentioned here is that, yes, we have done this on a monometallic nanoparticles, and as you mentioned, and as I showed also in my talk, that you expect that when you have a partial pressure of your adsorbate carbon monoxide, the equilibrium shape will change in the presence of a reactive environment. Now, when you have binaries, this is a more complex story, because there are two things that change. When you have the adsorption of when you have a partial pressure of your reactant, we take this into consideration with the chemical potential of CO, for example. But what happens here is that the chemical ordering will change. So not only the shape of your nanoparticle will change, but also the chemical ordering, because you expect that the adsorbates have a preference for one metal over the other. So the chemical ordering of your nanoparticle will change. So now what you need to take into account is to run your genetic algorithm and predict the equilibrium shape, the equilibrium chemical ordering in the presence of CO at different CO coverages, and construct your nanoparticle ensemble at the specific reaction conditions in the equilibrium shapes, in the most on the equilibrium shapes in the presence of CO. But again, like to answer your questions, we have not applied this so far to the bimetallic nanoparticles, because you have the complexity of the chemical ordering. The shape will definitely change, and the chemical ordering will change. And we take into account, again, with statistical thermodynamics, by taking into consideration the chemical potential of carbon monoxide and vibration frequencies, and again, statistical thermodynamics. But this is an excellent question. This is a high degree of complexity when you go to bimetallics, and this is something that we are currently working on.
Yeah, thank you. So, say you take into account adsorption, desorption, right? So basically, and that depends on temperature. So you will have some coverage of CO on each of these nanoparticles, and then at that coverage, some of the sites will be blocked, right? And so the kinetics will be different. So can you explain how this is actually taken into account in these simulations? For example, say sticking of CO to certain sites, because adsorption energy strongly depends on coordination, right?
Yes.
So you block some of the, say, low coordinated sites very easily with a CO, but then depending on temperature, kinetics will be very different.
Yeah, so just to clarify, we don't take into consideration the kinetics of any kinetics of the nanoparticle. The kinetics that we take into consideration here are the kinetics of the reaction of the CO dissociation. All right. But now to answer your question, yes, we have lateral interaction between CO at different coverages. And we take this into consideration in this ACS catalysis work. We have developed a model that you take into consideration the energetics of your nanoparticle, the energetics from the binding of CO, and also repulsion interactions from the different coverages based on the surface area of your nanoparticle and the number of CO molecules that you have in your nanoparticle. So we take into consideration lateral interactions on the equilibrium shape predictions. Now, the kinetics that we take into account come from the BEP relationships that I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, that basically based on the surface that you have, and we assume also a mean field approximation because you can have also a fast diffusion of your reactants, based on the surface and the sites that you expose, how you would expect the kinetics of your reaction to change according to the coordination environment that I mentioned before. So this is how we take this into consideration.
Okay, yeah, thanks a lot.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
I see Robert Jones from the audience has the hand raised.
Hello, yes. So thank you very much again for the talk. It was absolutely fantastic. So my question is about the genetic algorithm that you were showing us, in that with these kind of machine learning techniques, to use the broad term on it, you tend to have the issue that there isn't necessarily a unique solution. And indeed, we see this in the figure in which you were showing us the evolution of your samples, and you can see a lot of variance as well with respect to. I apologize, I can't remember what the Y plot was, but you see a lot of variance within your population as you go down the samples. How does this morphologically actually manifest in the structures themselves? This variance, and if I've produced 50,000 or so generations, what will those two structures that could be spat out end up looking like, and how may they vary from one another?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So I agree that with the genetic algorithm, you have a stochastic nature, you will never be sure that this is your optimal solution. So I will discuss a little bit what the genetic algorithm does, and I have a slide here. We start with an initial population of 50 nanoparticles, and then we rank them in terms of the cohesive energy according to the bone-centric model that I described. And we have a crossover algorithm. This is the wheel selection algorithm that we can mate different parents, etc., according again to the cohesive energy that we calculate from the bone setting model. And then we have mutations, all right? And we come up with a new population. And we have this iterative scheme. And if we see that after 2000 generations, we don't have any new nanoparticles that are of chemical ordering that are of lower energy, then this is what is converged. Now, in the final step, what we additionally do, we do Monte Carlo. So we have, we take the equilibrium shape that the genetic algorithm predicts, and then we do some swaps. We do that for some thousands of swaps to see if we can come up with another particle that is of lower energy. If not, then this is the nanoparticle that we represent. The program actually spits out, and this is the most cohesive nanoparticle in terms of the chemical ordering. Does this answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I think we have time for one more question. I'm a bit conscious of time because people may have meetings to attend after this. So
Kevin Rossi from IBFL here.
Please go ahead.
I was wondering if your algorithm can describe and discuss the absorption of multidentate adsorbates currently, or if this is going to be done in the future. Thanks for the lovely talk.
Yeah. So okay. So the question is this is a very good question. If a different when you have different surface coverages, if you can have a case, for example, that some of your adsorbates take positions that are different than the top position. For example, they can be on a hollow or bridge position. Do I understand the question right? Is this right?
Yes, this one, or even bind two atoms at the same time because it's a big molecule. Like
yes, yes. So okay, right now, question, really. in the energetics that I showed you in the last slide on the rhodium nanoparticle changing, the shape change with respect to the carbon monoxide coverage, yes, it does, because at the end you take the, you see the how the energetics change when you, at high coverage, you expect to have also different positions of CO occupying on the, or different sites of the CO occupying on the nanoparticle surface. Now, with bimetallic configurations, no, we have not done this, but it is straightforward to, like when you have, for example, a carboxyl group adsorb, it's straightforward to apply this. I have to mention that these models, we have started to use them also on the nanoparticle synthesis thrust, where you have now, you stabilize the nanoparticles in the presence of ligands, surface ligands, and you can have different adsorption configuration surface ligands. And the answer is that yes, you can develop models that you have bidentate adsorption and different adsorption sites. Of course, this involves more work, but you can do it, yes. And also different types of
adsorption. Okay, I think we can close this session. So Yanni, thank you very much again for this beautiful talk. I think everybody learned quite a lot, and we really enjoyed your presentation. So with that, thank you all for attending as well, and I look forward to the next event by the Thomas Young Center.
Great. Thank you all very much, and thank you for the great opportunity to present in the Thomas Young Center of London. It was a great pleasure.
Thank you, Yanni.
Thank you, Giannis.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.